Hi, welcome to our video on diabetic medications. We're going to talk about the risks of insulin. Now, insulin is a hormone that allows glucose to be absorbed by your muscles. They've got a great graphic for you there right on your screen. So take a look at insulin. It's those yellow shapes, and you see they're perfectly shaped to fit into that receptor. When insulin binds to that receptor, it opens up an entryway, and you can see those little blue molecules represent glucose being able to leave the bloodstream and go into the cell. So insulin binds to those receptors, and they're on the plasma membranes of the cell, and tissues can absorb the glucose in the bloodstream. See, that's the problem. If you don't have insulin, you don't have any way to get the glucose from your bloodstream into your cells as an energy source. And that's why a diabetic patient's glucose levels are high. So what do you think is the worst case scenario, the worst possible thing that can happen for a patient who receives insulin? Sometimes people are shocked to learn that we're not as worried about the high blood sugar as we are the risk of low blood sugar for people who are on insulin. Because if they have inadequate glucose, they're going to starve your brain and your body for their main source of fuel. So the symptoms for low blood sugar can range from mild to life-threatening. So the biggest risk for any patient, type 1 or type 2, that's receiving insulin is hypoglycemia. So go ahead and just write that word out again to remind yourself. Biggest risk, WCS. Worst case scenario, low blood sugar. Okay, just a quick review of what the signs and symptoms are of low blood sugar. The patient will become kind of anxious. They might have a headache, or as it progresses, they could even lead to seizures. They might have some neural changes. They might be kind of confused, not be able to think clearly. Remember, we're talking about a finger stick blood sugar that's probably low, like less than 50 low when it gets to that point. Now, their heart might start racing. That's because their body's response is to try to hit that sympathetic nervous system to raise that blood sugar by kicking out stored glucose. They're going to feel nauseated or sick to their stomach, really pretty weak, sweaty and tremory. So those are the signs you're looking for low blood sugar. Just a special note, if your patient's on a medication like a beta blocker, you're not going to see that fast heart rate, okay? So you want to remind them to watch their blood sugar really closely. So they're going to feel kind of disoriented. They're going to be confused. They might have some neural changes. If it really progresses, it could lead to coma. Their heart's going to be racing. They're kind of sweaty and shaky. Remember, this is with the finger stick blood sugar lower than 50. So now we know what hypoglycemia looks like, let's look at how we treat it in a patient. If they have mild to moderate hypoglycemia, we can just give them some carbohydrate-rich food. Make sure they're able to swallow safely. But if their blood sugar is getting a little low, we just give them a carbohydrate-rich food, and that should help raise their blood sugar. Be sure to keep checking their blood sugar to watch its progress. Now, if there's severe hypoglycemia, we can use IV glucose. That'll raise their blood glucose immediately, right? Because we give it right into their bloodstream. But we only use that in the hospital setting. Let's say they're at home and their blood sugar is drastically low. They can use sub-Q glucagon, but this doesn't kick in as quick. It takes about 20 minutes for a response. So we can use it at home. Let's say you've called the ambulance, you're waiting for them to come. This will encourage the glycogen breakdown in the liver. So they're going to need food when they wake up and they're able to swallow to keep that reaction going, but the sub-Q glucagon will take 20 minutes. Here's the note though, glucagon will only work best if the patient has stored glycogen. So if they're in a severe malnourished state, this really isn't going to help you. Got to make sure that liver has some stored energy in it, otherwise the sub-Q glucagon won't be helpful. Now, we mentioned it briefly, but I want to go back over that point again. People who are receiving beta blockers, when they drop blood sugar, they have a low blood sugar, you're not going to see that heart rate as elevated, and the body's also not going to be able to break down that glycogen. So people on beta blockers who are also diabetic or receiving insulin, this is something you want them to be very aware of. They're not going to show you the normal signs and symptoms, so they need to be really vigilant in checking their blood sugar. For you observing the patient, they start to show you some signs of confusion, that is a sign you'll see, and you want to check their blood sugar immediately. Now, there's other medications, if they're taken with insulin, the patient has an increased risk for hypoglycemia. So sulfonylureas and meglitinides, those two drugs will lower any blood sugar. Even if it's already normal or low, it could lower it to really risky areas. We talked about beta blockers. The reason you have falling blood sugar with that one, because your body can't hit that sympathetic nervous system response to break out the stored energy. And lastly, you'd think alcohol that has carbs would make your blood sugar go up, but it doesn't in patients with insulin. Insulin and alcohol, you have an increased risk for low blood sugar. So go through those examples one more time. See if you can answer the question to yourself, why do sulfonylureas and meglitinides cause an increased risk for hypoglycemia? Why do beta blockers cause an increased risk for hypoglycemia? And what's up with alcohol? Will their blood sugar go up or go down? Yes, yeah, sometimes just listening to an educator go through the concepts, I call that bobbleheading in my classroom. People can follow along with me like I'm a bouncing ball in karaoke. But unless you stop, pause, and ask yourself questions, it's not doing you the kind of benefit that you really want when it comes to taking a test and knowing the safest thing to do for your patients in practice. So always take the time to stop, pause a video whenever you want, and ask yourself some questions. Now, there's an elevated blood sugar risk with these medications. So we talked about the medications that put you at risk for a low blood sugar. Now let's look at those that if you use these, they have an increased risk for elevated blood sugar. Thiazide diuretics, glucocorticoids for sure, and sympathomimetics. Now let's go back and talk about why. Thiazide diuretics just have that side effect. That's as complex as you need to get for this. Glucocorticoids will elevate anyone's blood sugar, and it's particularly problematic for diabetic patients. Sympathomimetics are drugs that mimic the sympathetic nervous system. Remember, that's that epinephrine and norepinephrine that encourages your liver to break out that stored energy when you think you need to really kick it into high gear. Well, sympathomimetics will cause that reaction in your liver, which will therefore elevate your blood sugar. So when I'm thinking about medications that put a diabetic client or somebody on insulin at risk for elevated blood sugar, thinking thiazide diuretics, glucocorticoids, and sympathomimetics. Thank you for watching our video today. You may have found it surprising to think about the biggest risk with insulin is hypoglycemia, but by knowing the risk factors, how to watch for them, and what to do, you can help keep your patients safe.